Okay, are there any questions from previous lectures? I hope you feel comfortable interrupting me at any point while I'm lecturing. So I just wanted to finish up one topic from yesterday. We talked about proton decay operators. In particular, we had this operator. Had basically three Qs and an L and a 1 over lambda squared because it was from a dimension 6 operator. And we said this led to proton decay. And the idea here is, so the one slight complication is that the operator involves quarks and not protons. And so what is going on here is that this operator has the right quantum numbers to create a proton. So we could say that this operator looks like some z factor to create a proton, but it also creates other things like a proton pi zero. So there's a whole bunch of terms there. It's strong interaction mess. So you have an operator here that's producing three quarks. But so this could produce a proton, or you could put in an extra quark anti-quark pair with some gluons and produce a proton pi zero, and so on. It's a whole mess of stuff, and we don't know what those z factors are. We'd have to compute those in lattice QCD. But you know, we can estimate their size because just by dimensions, this is dimension 3/2. This is dimension, know what sort of dimensions we need Z to have, and we'll just say it's lambda QCD to some power, and maybe we're off by some factors. We're off by an order of magnitude, but we're, when we're at least in the crude approximation, we're trying to at least, we're just working with orders of magnitude. But when you actually want to ask what sort of reach does a proton decay experiment have, you have to go to the lattice and start computing these things. Now, I want to point out that actually for proton decay, you can't have proton go Z plus. That does not that violates energy, and this does not is not going to violate energy. So it's actually not this operator that is coming in; it's this one. And so, I actually got sort of curious, though. What about this one? What does this operator do? Well, if you look at it, it says that it leads to an operator that looks like proton E plus times some lambda QCD cubed over lambda squared. I know that the coefficient has to have dimensions of mass because it looks like a mass term. So I put in the right powers of lambda QCD. And okay, so that doesn't lead to proton decay, but it does lead to mixing between the proton and the positron. And it's sort of interesting that even if, so I was curious about what this did, and of course, if you stick in numbers, you realize this is ridiculously small. This mass scale is something like 10 to the minus 65, I forget, electron volts or GeV, it doesn't matter. Okay, it's really small. But just as a theorist, it's sort of interesting to notice that if I did not have a Higgs field in the weak interactions, suppose I just erase the Higgs field from the standard model, then you would think, especially if you read all the propaganda from CERN that this is the origin of all mass, that everything would be massless. But first of all, we know that if we turned off the Higgs, the proton would still be massive, because we know that the up quark weighs about 2.5 MeV. This is from lattice calculations, and 5 MeV. And we know that, for example, the proton neutron mass difference is about 2 MeV, which is basically due to it has two origins, and they're about equal in size. One is due to the mass difference between the quarks, and one is due to the electromagnetic corrections. It's a very interesting, bizarre feature in the real world that, let me put it this way, that the electromagnetic and the quark mass contributions are almost equal. And it's really important for your existence, by the way, because if you look at this, you would say, oh, the neutron is going to be, What am I doing here? Right, if you looked at just the electromagnetic corrections, you'd say the proton's charged, the neutron's not, the proton should be heavier. Okay, if the proton was heavier, then it would decay into neutrons. There would be a neutron gas in the early universe, no atoms, no life. Very boring. So luckily, this comes in and switches the order of the masses. And interestingly enough, almost by the same amount as the electromagnetic does, and it gives us the small difference which makes life possible. So that's sort of an interesting, weird feature of the universe. But it also tells us that the quark mass contributions to the baryon masses are very small. Okay, this is not where the proton mass comes from. So the proton. So we think that if we set all the quark masses to zero, such as by getting rid of the Higgs, the proton would still weigh about the same as it does now, within a few MeV. So first of all, there's something curious. How do things get massive without a Higgs? Okay, and then the second thing that's also weird is that not only does the proton get massive, but because of this operator, the electron would get massive, because it would mix with a massive proton. You'd get a mass matrix where you'd have basically m proton from the QCD contributions, and then you'd have this lambda QCD squared over cubed over lambda gut squared contribution due to the mixing. And so you'd find that not only is the proton massive, but I mean this matrix does not have any zero eigenvalues. You'd find that the electron mass, I mean I wrote positron here, but of course there's plus Hermitian conjugate, so also the electron. You'd find the electron gets a mass that would look like lambda QCD to the 6 over lambda gut to the 4th times 1 over m proton, which is also roughly lambda QCD. So we'd get something that goes like to the 5th over lambda gut to the 4th. Absolutely. Not interesting in terms of a number, but interesting for as an idea that without the Higgs, everything gets massive. Okay. So, and furthermore, the electron's no longer a point-like particle because that mass eigenstate is a mix between the point-like lepton and the composite proton. So, theorists don't have too many tools. So, whenever you have a tool, you try to apply it to every problem you've ever thought of. Okay. If you learn anything from my lectures, that should be it. Okay, so one thing that's sort of amusing by this is, first of all, the fact that the proton gets massive means that the weak interactions have to be broken. And they have to be broken by QCD. And this was the observation that led to Technicolor. Because the origin of the proton mass is largely due to chiral symmetry breaking, the fact that in QCD, the vacuum gives you a non-zero condensate of left-handed and right-handed quarks. And now in the standard model, left-handed quarks are doublets under the weak interactions, and right-handed quarks are singlets. So this breaks the weak interactions. That is how the proton's able to get a mass without a Higgs. So Technicolor said, oh, well, let's get rid of the Higgs. As we'll talk about, the Higgs has certain problems associated with its mass. There's a fine-tuning issue. So Technicolor says, let's imagine there's a super QCD, we'll call it Technicolor, with techni quarks, and everything is about the same, but instead of this, we're going to have techni quarks, which are have left-handed doublets and right-handed singlets, and they get a condensate which is ramped up to the weak scale, and they break the weak interactions through this non-trivial dynamical means. So that's the idea behind Technicolor. And then you could say, well, how do the ordinary quarks get masses? And the usual way that people do it in extended Technicolor is they say, oh, well, they're just going to basically say, let's reproduce what the Higgs does by saying that behaves sort of like a Higgs, and then let's put our quarks down next to them. And then when this gets a VeV, it looks like the Higgs-Yukawa coupling. But of course, this is a dimension 6 operator, so there's a new scale, lambda ETC squared, which goes in there. And so this is how we'll give the quarks mass. So this is what's called extended Technicolor. And it ran into problems because you also tend to generate four quark operators that violate, give you delta S equals 2 and delta S equals 1 operators that are in violation of what we see in the KON system. So, and furthermore, by now we would have seen all sorts of resonances and technipions and so on. So this is not a very viable theory. But the interesting thing is that this tells us, this example over here tells us there's a different route for getting a mass for a fermion, which is instead of having this type of operator, you could have this type of operator. Now you have technicolor cubed times your lepton or quark or whatever. And this gives you mass via mixing with technibaryons. Okay, and in this picture, ordinary fermions can be partially composite without having to invoke anything more exotic than QCD-like interactions. So normally, it's very difficult to come up with the theory of composite fermions so the proton is a composite fermion, and we understand it because the size of the proton is set by the same scale as its mass. Okay, the mass is on the order of lambda QCD, the size is order lambda QCD inverse. But we know that the ordinary quarks and leptons aren't like that. Their masses are small and they're point-like as far as we can see. This gives you actually a way to, using QCD-like dynamics, to have them be at least partially composite by mixing with a heavy composite object which is small, and we would not have seen its compositeness yet because we haven't been able to probe up to that scale. So it's just a different way of getting mass for fermions. And this is actually another building block that people now use for composite Higgs models and stuff like that. Anyway, the only reason I brought this up is because I want you to remember that whenever you find something that has some sort of interesting dynamical effect, immediately say to yourself, oh, where else can I apply this? What other problem could I solve with this? That is, after all, how Nambu came up with this picture for QCD, which is correct, which is that he said, oh, superconductivity is really cool. Maybe that sort of thing could happen in quantum field theory. And that's going to segue into a topic I'll talk about later today, which is how does superconductivity work? Any questions? So what I was going to do next is talk about how I was going to sketch in practice how one does a top-down sort of effective field theory and why you'd want to do it. I'm not going to go through any extensive calculations here, but the idea is you have some energy scale and you have your high energy theory. So for example, your grand unified theory, say, and then you have a matching scale and below that you have your effective field theory with light degrees of freedom. Such as the standard model in this example. And then way down here, you have your scale mu, which is the energy of whatever experiment you're doing, whether it's looking at the mass of a B quark or looking at radiative corrections of the Z mass and so on. So the idea then is that you take your full theory and you match it onto the effective theory and you scale it down. And the question is, how do you do the matching and how do you do the scaling? And more importantly, why do I do this? Why don't I just calculate everything in the grand unified theory? So part of the reason here that makes it's not just a question of simplicity. You actually run into problems. If you just try to take the grand unified theory and you calculate, say, radiative corrections of the Z mass, you're going to find that your calculations are going to have things that go like alpha times log of m gut over mz. Now, this log is about 30 or something, okay? So alpha times 30 is not a very good expansion parameter. So you want to RG improve the theory. You want to sum up all of these leading log terms. That's what the renormalization group does. It replaces this by alpha. So this is alpha at m gut. It replaces this by alpha at mz. And it's equivalent to summing up all these leading logs. If you solve the beta function to two loops, you're summing up alpha log squared, and so on. So it's a way of improving the theory by getting rid of these large logs. Now, the only way you can solve the renormalization group equation is if you use what's called a mass-independent subtraction scheme. And the obvious one that everybody uses is MS-bar. Now, the nice thing about MS-bar is the following. It's a feature and it's a bug. You know that the physical origin of running couplings is basically vacuum polarization. You know that the reason why alpha changes as you probe closer or farther from charged particles is because the E plus E minus pairs in the vacuum. So you would expect that alpha, if I looked at alpha versus energy, you know that because of the screening, you expect that as you go to lower energy, you're going farther away, there's more screening, and so you expect that alpha, let me put log here, is going down. But the thing that's doing the screening is the electron. So you'd expect that somehow at m electron, log of m electron, the screening would stop. Once you're farther away from your charged particle than the Compton wavelength of the electron, you're not going to be getting any more electron-positron pairs. You don't get bigger and bigger pairs because it's too improbable for an electron-positron pair to pop out of the vacuum, exist a kilometer apart, and come back together. They're not going to be much farther than a Compton wavelength of the electron. So the running should have this changeover at m electron. That's sort of the physics of what's going on. That's why we don't talk about running coupling constants when we're doing atomic physics. It doesn't make a difference which atomic level you're measuring alpha in, because you're at energies way below the electron mass, way below half an MeV. But if you calculate the beta function in a gauge theory, you know that you get things like, 11/3 NC minus 2/3 K fermion plus da-da-da. And the beta function has no mass scale in it. And that's why it is possible to solve the renormalization group equations. That's why it's called a mass-independent subtraction scheme. But built into this beta function, there's no change. As you go it doesn't say that you use a different beta function up here or down there. And so now all of a sudden, you have to ask, why do people use the beta function they do for PD when maybe up above the gut scale, there are a gazillion more colored particles? And shouldn't I include those in the beta function too? Because there's no reference to scale here. So there are many different beta functions I could use depending on how many colored particles I have in my theory. And I don't even know how many colored particles there are if I go up to the Planck scale. So the problem with MS bar is that you cannot use this beta function everywhere. You'll actually run into problems. You'll end up finding that you don't get rid of the large logs you thought you were getting rid of. And what you have to do is you have to use the beta function appropriate to the high energy theory up here, and then you have to match onto a low energy theory at the mass where you integrate out the heavy particles and use the low energy beta function down here. And so in the gut, you're going to be using the beta function appropriate to SU5. Down here, you can use the beta function appropriate to the standard model. Somewhere here, if you're doing really low energy physics, you're going to go through the top quark threshold. And so up here, you're going to have 6 quarks, but down here, you're going to have 5 quarks in your beta function. And you have to integrate out the top quark and match to the new beta function. So it is actually not possible to sum up all of these logs and do it right unless you do this effective field theory procedure. And the way to look at it is that, really, you've got a whole bunch of different types of logs. You've got log of m gut over mz, and you've got alpha of log m gut over m top, and you've got alpha log m gut over the b quark mass, and so on. And so if you just try to do RG improvement up from the top, you're going to find that you can't get rid of all of these, okay? And so what the effective field theory does is that it sums up all of these down to the top mass, and then you run from the top to the Z mass, which basically I'm saying that you can think of this as alpha log m gut over m top, And then another contribution looks like alpha m gut m top over mz. This is a better way of writing it. Sorry, not m gut, m top over mz, mz over mb, and so on. And so what the first scaling down to them to top sums up all these guys, and then the second scaling where you've integrated out the top sums up all of those logs, getting rid of mz then sums up all of those logs, getting rid of mb, and so on. So especially if you're doing strong interaction corrections to, say, a proton decay operator, and you want to scale it all the way down to a GV, you have to use this effective field theory approach to sum them up. Even more dramatically, suppose you want to, one of the great predictions of the grand unified theory is that you can predict what sine squared theta weak is, which is G1 over, well, tan theta squared is G1 squared over G2 squared, the ratio of the couplings for the U1 to the SU2. Because in the grand unified theory, they're equal. And so at tree level, what happens is you get a non-zero ratio for this simply because the U1 is normalized differently in the standard model than it is in the gut. So you get a prediction that sine squared theta, I believe, is 3/8, 0.36. 0.36 is a pretty bad number for sine squared theta, which is around 0.21. But then that was the prediction in the original Georgi Glashow paper, but then Georgi Quinn-Weinberg said, oh, but we should RG improve this. Let's run the couplings down, because these couplings do not run the same way as I go down at low energy. So then they do the RG scaling and the effective theory and end up with a number which is about 0.23 or 0.21. In fact, the history there is sort of interesting. They first predicted 0.36 at a time when the experimental number was about 0.3 with error bars small enough so that 0.36 was excluded. And then over time, the experimental number started going up. The experimental number started going up to 0.36, and then it was consistent. But Georgi Quinn-Weinberg came out with their paper saying it was actually 0.21 and was completely excluded. And then the experimental number started coming down to 0.21 until it was at 0.21 with very small error bars. And then Georgi Dimopoulos wrote down the first paper on the MSSM and supersymmetric SU5. And because of the gluino and higgsinos, it changed the prediction slightly to 0.23, which was excluded at the time. And then the experimental number went up to 0.23. This doesn't usually happen this way. So there are practical reasons for knowing how to do this. And the way we're going to do the matching, the question is, how do you organize the calculation? How do you do the matching? And what about all this talk from the 30s about these theories being non-renormalizable, and how do I deal with this? So I'm going to, just as a very simple example that I'm, as I said, I'm not going to actually do the calculation, I'm just going to sketch it. I'm going to take sort of the simplest effective field theory I could imagine. So we're going to say our high energy theory has two scalars. Phi, which is light, and S, which is heavy. And they have a cubic interaction only. So a free term for the phi field, a free term for the S field with big M, much, much bigger than little m. And then a cubic interaction where kappa has dimensions of mass. And I want to integrate out the S field and write down the effective theory for the phi field. Now, I'm also going to assume then that kappa over big M is much less than 1 is going to be what justifies using perturbation theory. Now the question is, how do you organize the calculation? And the general way one does it is you organize it in a loop expansion. Now, a loop expansion, if you remember your path integral looked like e to the I s over h bar, where s is your action, you can show that a loop expansion is formally expansion in powers of h bar. Okay, I'm not going to go through the calculation there, but basically if you count up, if you say every propagator has a power of h bar, every vertex has a power of 1 over h bar, if I just calculate the Feynman rules from this, external legs have a certain power. You find that the loop expansion is equivalent to expansion in h bar, where the tree level is h bar to the minus 1, loop is h bar to the 0, 2 loops is h bar to the first power, and so on. Now, we're not trying to claim that h-bar is small. In fact, it's dimensionful, so we usually set it to 1. But what I'm going to show you, though, is that this is equivalent to a perturbative expansion, and that is because you know that you have Euler's formula, which says that for a given graph, you have this relationship where this is the number of loops, L is the number of loops, P is the number of propagators, and V is the number of vertices. So you start with that. This is true for any graph. The way, one way of seeing that this is true is looking at a Feynman diagram and remembering that at every vertex you have a momentum conserving delta function. And for every loop, you have an integration over momenta. And if you want, you say your Feynman diagram in the end should have one delta function, namely total momentum conservation. You find that if you take the number of integrations and the number of delta functions from the vertices and so on, that you'll get this result. So if your theory, if your vertex has if it's a n particle vertex, then you have that the number of external lines plus twice the number of propagators is equal to nv, because this is just a statement that every line you draw in your graph either has to end on an external particle or has to end on a vertex. And a propagator has two ends that have to end on vertices. So every external leg has to have one end that ends on a vertex, and every propagator has to have two ends that end on a vertex. And the number of vertices times the number of legs coming out of it is nv. So you put these together, and you end up getting that the number of vertices is equal to 2l plus e minus 2 divided by n minus 2. We're always going to have n bigger than 2. We're not talking about a mass term as a vertex. So 3, 4, 5, whatever. So n minus 2 is not 0 or negative. And the main thing I want you to see is that as for given a graph with a given number of external legs, as the number of internal loops goes up, the number of vertices goes up. And therefore, doing a loop expansion is equivalent to doing expansion in powers of vertices, which is what we normally call perturbation theory. So this is consistent with perturbation theory. It's just it's justified not because h bar is small, but because your coupling constants are small. So then, that means that what we do is we start off by doing our matching at tree level. So this is like the calculation I did the other day for the Fermi theory. We just integrated out the W at tree level due to what G Fermi was. We didn't calculate loop corrections to that. So let's just do that now. So what do you get for your low energy theory? As I said, I'm not going to, I'm going to put 0 up here to tell me I'm working at 0 loops.
Well, you first write down what you would get if you just erased the heavy field. But then you have to also start adding together. I'll use a wavy line for my S. So this is my S propagator. The rule is you have to make sure that the S matrix elements are the same in the full theory and in the effective theory. So this is the three-level exchange that I've got in my original theory that has four external legs, and this has to equal my four scalar vertex in the effective theory, and I'm going to put a zero up above this to remind you that this is just the vertex at tree level, zero loops. So I'm going to get a term then that looks like minus phi fourth. Again, my phis may look different, but they're always the same. Over 4 factorial. And now, what is the size of this? Well, I'm looking at an operator with no derivatives on phi field, which means I can match with zero external momentum. Then it's very easy. My propagator just gives me a 1 over ms squared, and the vertices give me a kappa squared. So I get a kappa squared over big M squared, and then I get some numerical factor, which is order 1, which just, you know, comes from actually computing these diagrams, which I'm not going to do. So I get that. I'm also going to get something that looks like minus d0 from these same diagrams, where I now say, well, now I'm going to put some external momentum, but by assumption, my external momenta are small, just like little m is doing an experiment at low energy, and therefore I can do a Taylor expansion in the external momentum, and that'll translate into an operator that has a derivative acting on two of the scalar fields and no derivatives acting on the other two scalar fields, and then this is going to be going to look like have a kappa to the kappa squared, because it still has two vertices, but it's going to have an m to the fourth, big m to the fourth. So all I've done here is really Taylor expanded these propagators and taken the order p squared correction. And that p is the external momentum, so it looks like an operator with derivatives on the external leg. It's important to note that when you're doing the matching, if you're only interested in this coefficient, don't do these diagrams for arbitrary external momentum. Set the external momentum to zero from the start. It's much easier. And so on. So remember, I'm assuming that kappa over m is small, and therefore this gives me a perturbative phi-fourth coupling. Okay, so that's straightforward. That's not doesn't involve any confusion. But now, what happens when we do loops? In which diagrams do I include? Because the problem is this low energy theory. Already has an order H bar contribution of this form. I've got zero H bars in the vertices there, and I get an H bar from the loop. So that's an order H bar contribution from the effective theory. The high energy theory, I get things like it goes like that. I get graphs like that, and so on. I also get graphs for example, that look like this. Let me just leave it like this. So it looks like a little bit confusing, because I want to find this vertex, for example, but how much of this, what is this supposed to do? Because I also have that vertex, I mean this graph, so there's some, I get several contributions in the low energy theory at order H bar. What do I match them to? So the right way to do it, and notice that there's something important here. This graph here will have a cut. So you're going to expect something that looks like, say, log of typically you'll get something like log of 4 p squared over m squared or something like that. Maybe I have the 4 wrong, p squared over 4 m squared, I forgot. But this is non-analytic, okay? If you tried, but this graph here also has that cut. This cut comes from the fact that these two intermediate particles can be on shell. Now, if I tried to match this graph onto a contact interaction, I'd have a problem because it has this log here. And I'm not allowed to put logs of derivatives in my Lagrangian. But the cool thing is that because this comes from an analytic, this non-analytic stuff comes from these particles being on shell, in fact, you'll find that you get exactly the same logs in these two diagrams. So in fact, the non-analytic things are already taken into account in this low energy theory. You don't have to add them in. So the right way to do the matching is you take your you take the diagrams in the high energy theory, which are one light particle irreducible, and these have to equal the sum of diagrams at order L in the EFT. Now, what do I mean by light particle irreducible? These are graphs that do not fall apart when I cut a light line. So these are one light particle irreducible because if I cut, the only way to make it fall apart is to cut a heavy line. And I'm not, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about cutting a light line. So for example, a diagram, like if I take the lowest order vertex, and then I say, what do I want to do? If I look at that diagram, okay, this is not one of the things I match in the high energy theory, because if I cut this line here, it would fall apart. And the reason why I don't do that is because this is already taken into account in the low energy theory by this diagram. Because this vertex here is this vertex with the S propagator shrunk. So I've already taken this into account in the low energy theory. So I don't want to say this is an additional contribution. So I only sum up the diagrams in the high energy theory that are one light particle irreducible and match those to the low energy theory. And I want to do this in the loop expansion. So at one loop, then, the diagrams I have to consider in the high energy theory are, for example, we have to do this not only in the loop expansion, but we also have to do it for different numbers of external legs. So let's first look at two external legs. So those correspond to these diagrams. Well, that diagram, okay. And in the low energy theory, so let me put equals two. In the low energy theory, this corresponds to vertex 1, which either can be a mass term, or a wave function term. But when I do the matching, I don't want to just equate this to this, because the low energy theory already has a term that's order h bar, where I take the order 0 vertex, phi-fourth vertex, and I construct that loop. So I have to take the sum of these things. There's a new vertex here for the wave function, a new vertex for the mass term, and this diagram that already exists in this tree level theory, where I take the phi-fourth interaction here. So this thing here is what I'm calling 0. And I close off the loop. You can see why this has to be included, because if I shrink this line down to a point, which is how I got this vertex in the first place, this thing here becomes, well, becomes this diagram there, because I pull this vertex over to that vertex, and I get this. But I might find that, in fact, this is not exactly equal to this. There's some leftover piece, and that's what I stick into my correction term. And if I look at external legs 4, the high energy theory, I have the, I've got this diagram, I've got this diagram, I've got this diagram, and a bunch more. And in the low energy theory, I first of all have all the one loop diagrams I construct with the zero h-bar vertex. So that's this, this, and this. So these are the graphs that already exist. And then I get a new correction, which is what I call 1. Now, as I said, I'm not going to compute these. Let me just estimate them. And we're going to do this in, if you do this in MS bar, the thing that you get from this correction here . Well, if I take out the wave function renormalization, I'm going to get something that looks like A1 kappa squared over 16 pi squared m squared, 16 pi squared just because it's a loop, times d phi squared. Well, so that's going to be, I should draw it down to here. This is the wave function term. How did I get that? Well, I want the piece that goes like d phi squared. Its coefficient has to be dimensionless. It's got a 1 over 16 pi squared because it's coming matching a loop. It's got to have a kappa squared in it. It's, therefore, by dimensions, there's got to be a 1 over m squared downstairs. And in principle, you might get a log, but I'm choosing my renormalization scale to be capital M for convenience. My perturbation expansion work well, so the log that I would get, log mu over m, is 0. So there are no large logs in this calculation. So this is the typical term I would get for the wave function term, the correction, with A1 on the order 1. But I'd also get a mass correction. Well, first of all, let's look at what sort of mass correction do you expect from this, okay? Well, this has that vertex, kappa squared over m squared. This would be a 1 over 16 pi squared. And then I've got a quadratically divergent graph that involves the propagator of the light field. What does dimreg do with that? If I compute integral d4q, 1 over q squared plus little m squared, what does dimreg give me for that? Does it know anything about the heavy mass? Right? It can't, right? This graph has no reference at all to the heavy S mass, no big M. It's got dimensions of mass squared. Dimreg does the only thing it could do, which is gives you something that goes like m squared. So this graph is going to give me this vertex, that's the lambda phi fourth coupling, times m squared, little m squared. Is everybody with me on that? The big mass only appears as a coupling constant, which in Feynman rules just comes out in front. The integral itself only involves a light propagator, so the answer is only going to depend on the light mass. So I get this. That looks pretty good. That's a small correction to the original mass I had. But what about this diagram? I need to know this diagram too to understand how big this correction is. Okay, so I know what already exists. I have to see what the high energy theory gives. The high energy theory gives me a graph that looks like D4Q 1 over so there's a kappa squared because of the vertices. Then there's this sort of integral in there, okay? So this sort of integral is a log divergent integral. So you're going to get something that looks like log big M squared over mu squared. And this has a kappa squared in front. So this correction is going to go like a term that goes like 1 over 16 pi squared times kappa squared phi squared. Now, I told you that kappa was much less than big M, but it can be way bigger than little m in principle. I never said it had to be small compared to little m. So you have the potential here for getting a huge mass correction to the scalar field by integrating out this heavy particle. Now, this theory underemphasizes how bad this could be because I gave you a phi cubed interaction. If I'd given you a phi fourth interaction like that, now I would find that in this case, if my original high energy theory had had a phi fourth interaction, then I would have had a correction that goes like this. And this would look like lambda over 16 pi squared times integral of d4q times 1 over, well, 1 over q squared plus big M squared. And here's a quadratically divergent diagram that only knows about the mass big M, and so I'd get lambda over 16 pi squared times big M squared in that graph, and therefore I would get a correction in my low energy theory, which goes like lambda over 16 pi squared big M squared times phi squared, because the low energy graph can't give me anything that cancels off against that. So it all has to come from the next term in the matching. So this is huge. This is potentially huge if kappa is much bigger than at big M. And what we see then is that at one loop, we get a very large additive correction to the scalar mass, namely that it turns out in the effective theory, the mass of phi is not at all related to the little m you put in, but is related to the big masses scales of the stuff you integrated out. This is the origin of the fine-tuning problem for the Higgs mass, because say at a gut, you're going to integrate out heavy stuff, and it's going to shift the mass of the Higgs by order m gut squared. Mass squared will shift by order m gut squared. Okay. So our effective theory now at order one, well, we have our 1/2 d phi squared. Now we have 1 plus something that's going to look like kappa squared over 16 pi squared m squared, which is a small correction. We're going to have a 1/2 phi squared times, I'm going to write this as little m squared. Oh, let me just write this. Little m squared plus b1 times kappa squared over 16 pi squared. That's going to be our matching term for the mass. And now we have to go on to the phi fourth. And when you do that, you're going to find minus phi fourth over 4 factorial. And then your tree level result was C0 times kappa squared over m squared. And what you find for your one loop result is going to go like kappa to the fourth over 16 pi squared m to the fourth. And then you have your d phi squared phi squared. Your tree level gave you something that looked like kappa squared over m to the fourth. So let me put a m squared out in front. Then you have a kappa squared m for m squared here. The fourth squared m to the fourth plus dot dot dot. And so you see that these expansions are well behaved. This expansion is well behaved. Everything is powers of kappa squared over m squared times 16 pi squared up here. So the only thing that's sort of bizarre is that additive correction. Everything else looks fine. So I can keep going. I can go to two loops and so on. Now, where in the world is all that trouble that people said we'd have when we looked at a non-renormalizable theory? So part of the problem that people said was that I'm going to, you know, if I start using operators like this one here, I'll get all sorts of terrible divergences with higher order derivatives and so on. In the MS bar scheme, it's especially transparent that in the low energy effective theory, you'll never get powers of big M upstairs. So if you use the momentum cutoff and you said my momentum cutoff is big M because that's how high my effective filter can go, then you'd have one over M's from the vertices, but you'd get powers of M upstairs from your momentum cutoff, from your divergent integrals. And it would look like there's not a very good expansion. But really, it'd just be a reordering of operators, but it would be a mess. But in MS bar, it's really simple because you don't have any propagators in your graphs that know about big M. They're all in the coupling. Big M only appears in coupling constants. And therefore, whenever you do integrals that are divergent, it only picks up powers of the mass of the scalar field, little m, if I fine-tune the mass to be small. Namely, if I actually did not take this to be small, but chose it to be big to almost exactly cancel this, then I would have a light scalar. That's the fine-tuning problem. But if I do that, then at every point when I look at a graph, there's only a light particle in the graph, and I never get powers, big powers, on top of the... I don't ever get a large mass divided by a large mass. I only get small masses divided by large masses. So as long as the theory is fine-tuned so that the light particle really is light, you will never get anything bad. You'll always get expansions like this for every operator. The fact that you get a divergence for something that, you know, I stopped here, but of course there are terms that go like, d to the 10th phi squared phi squared. Okay, so yes, it is true. I get contributions to extremely high dimension operators. But the reason why I don't have to pay attention to them is because this will come with powers of m to the 20th downstairs. Okay, and when I'm doing my experiment at low momentum, it will contribute to the amplitude by a power of momentum to the 20th over m to the 20th, which is the same small number I'm using for my expansion, so I ignore it. So the worry that there's an infinite number of operators with an infinite number of matching conditions is irrelevant because this operator is very unimportant in my expansion. So the effective filter is really two things. It's a perturbative expansion in cap over m, but it's also a derivative expansion in powers of derivatives over m. Okay, and because of that, I never am interested in the higher order operators. They're irrelevant. Okay, and so the whole worry from the 30s that the theory made no sense is not appropriate. So now I've matched my theory up to whatever order I want, up at the scale m. Now I can use the beta function and the low energy theory to scale down to the experimental scale of interest. And maybe I don't need to. Maybe the theory is weakly coupled and there are no large logs I have to worry about. But maybe there are, like in the gut theory, as I said, you're scaling over 30 decades, and therefore, 30 E-foldings, and therefore you get large logs, and so you do want to do the RG scaling. And basically, from numerical reasons, in a grand unified theory, because alpha at M gut is about equal to a 50th, and log of M gut over m weak is on the order of 30, something like that. Typically, what you want to do is you match at order l in the loop expansion with the L plus 1 loop beta function to do things consistently. That is to say that if I match a tree level, then I scale, I want to sum up all things that look like this. To do that, I need to use the one loop beta function. So I match a tree level, scale with the one loop beta function. Or if I want to do more precisely, if I really want to see whether there's coupling constant unification and a Suzy theory, I'll match at one loop level and use the two loop beta functions to do the running. And that's roughly consistent in size of corrections. The matching looks very funny when you look at the coupling constant. If I plot 1 over alpha versus log mu, at one loop, this is a linear relationship where the QCD coupling eventually, 1 over alpha 3, eventually it goes to 0, blows up, alpha blows up. The SU2 is, I think, mildly asymptotically free. The U1 is asymptotically unfree. And so here's the, say, MZ. And here's the gut theory. So here, they're at tree level, they're equal, because at tree level, basically, I'm just erasing the external heavy gauge bosons. They don't, at tree level, they don't change the gauge coupling. So all the coupling constants are equal up to a normalization issue. And then you run them down to the Z. But if you do one loop matching, you find that there's just, here's alpha 5. You'll find that these don't meet exactly here. They mismatch by small amounts because the one loop matching is a little bit different for alpha 1 as it is for alpha 2 as for alpha 3, and you calculate those little discontinuous jumps and then you scale using the two loop beta functions, and then they're not quite straight lines anymore. So that's the procedure, and it really, when you go through it once, you'll convince yourself that in fact all the worries about renormalizability are irrelevant, are not things to worry about. Now, this calculation, as I mentioned, shows one very peculiar thing, which is that we get these huge renormalizations to the mass of the scalar field. And in general, you'll notice that what mattered here was that this was a relevant operator, and therefore, whatever heavy mass scale I have in the high energy theory appears upstairs, not downstairs, in the correction. Okay, and therefore, makes a huge change in the original value. Now, this would seem to be a generic feature of any relevant operator, but there is an important exception to that, which is the fermion mass. So notice that the conclusion from this is that unless you came in there and at the beginning chose little m to be really big to cancel off perfectly that one loop correction and then the two loop correction and then the three loop correction, you wouldn't have a light scalar in the theory. There just would not be a light scalar. So light scalars should not exist in nature, this says, unless you have some reason to keep its mass small. So how could it, what sort of reason is there? So first of all, let's ask if all relevant operators are natural, and let's give an example, which is the fermion mass, say the electron mass in QED. Let's actually write down, say, QED, and let's put in a heavy particle. And let's integrate out the heavy particle and say, what's the effective theory? So they do couple because they couple through the photons. So there are graphs that couple the heavy particle to the light particle. And so the question is, this looks like a dimension 3 operator. And so the question is, do I get a term that looks like big M E bar E? Maybe over 16 pi squared? And maybe an alpha over 4 pi higher because they couple through the photon? So you might think that because they couple through the photon, through a loop, you'll get an alpha over 4 pi with a correction that goes like the big mass scale. That seems to be the lesson of what we just learned. But the answer is no. And the reason is because if I set m electron to zero, this theory would have a new symmetry. Namely, you could then write the kinetic term like this, which can be rewritten as e bar left I d slash e left plus e bar right I d slash e right. The mass term couples lefts to rights, but the kinetic term does not. And so this theory has a symmetry where e goes to e to the I theta gamma 5 e. This is called the chiral symmetry. Now, in fact, there's something called an anomaly in the symmetry, but it's not important for this discussion. Now, if the high energy theory has an exact symmetry, the low energy theory better have the same symmetry. But this operator would break the symmetry in a terrible way. So this operator cannot appear. Another way of saying it is that these basically look like independent particles. So even if I looked at some graph where I put my E up here and I coupled it down to the little e down here, these vertices flip left electrons to right electrons. So if this is e left, this is e left, and this is e left, and the operator that this generates can only be coupling an e left to an e left, which is a kinetic term. It could normalize this operator. This operator is marginal, so at most you can get something like log of your scale over big M, but I'm going to take my scale to be big M, and this log correction isn't there. So I cannot generate an operator like this because there's a symmetry. So what that means is that if I do turn on little me, I break that symmetry by breaking it by a small amount if me is small. And therefore, you find that renormalizations of electron mass, when me is not equal to zero, delta me is proportional to me. Because me is the only parameter in the theory that breaks this left to right symmetry, this chiral symmetry. So this is what we call multiplicative renormalization. And it protects the electron mass because it says then that delta me could look like me times pi times log of mu over big M. But there's no big M out in front, and I can choose mu to make that go away. So light fermion masses are natural. You would have to, by natural, what I mean is that these logs basically tell you that the scale that you have to worry about these types of renormalizations. Okay, sorry. This log here could be set to zero in the matching term, but you'll still get running of the electron mass due to beta function running. And the only way you'll ever run into trouble is if you run so far that alpha times a log is big. And that, because alpha is small, that scale is way, way, way above the Planck scale. So the theory of the electron is safe until a scale way above the Planck scale. So that's why we say there's no fine-tuning problem. See, in contrast, there was no symmetry in our scalar theory that protected the scalar mass. Well, if there's also this term here. So there's no symmetry in the theory that's broken by having M be non-zero. And therefore, I get an additive mass term, not a multiplicative one. So the moral from this is that if you want a light scalar, and it seems like we do, it seems like what the effective field theory analysis tells us that a light scalar requires one, either fine-tuning or two, a low cutoff scale before new physics comes in. And a third option really is that if you really say, I do want to take the theory all the way up to M Planck, so if the theory is good to M Planck, then above this low cutoff scale, of the EFT, you need a symmetry protecting the scalar mass. So the first question is, how low does this cutoff have to be? And then the second question is, what sort of symmetries could protect the scalar mass? So we've seen that the problem comes at one loop, typically. So if we have a Higgs, the change in its mass at one loop is going to be something like alpha over 4 pi times lambda squared. What is alpha? Well, alpha might be alpha 2, it might be alpha 1, it might be due to Yukawa coupling, really, instead of a gauge coupling. But there's some coupling constant squared over 4 pi, and we think the theory is perturbative, so this will be some relatively small number times lambda squared. And now, if you say that you want delta m Higgs squared to be less than or approximately 10 to the 2 JeV, because we don't want the rate of correction to be much larger than the mass we actually need, you end up finding that lambda has to be on the order of 1 TeV. And that's sort of partly the excitement about the LHC, is the hope that it's within the reach seeing what this new physics is. This is based on the idea that there's no fine tuning, because I could have put in a tree level mass that was up at the Planck scale for the Higgs that was just carefully designed to counter all the radiative corrections up to 10 loops or something, one part in 10 to the 17 fine-tuning, so that a light particle existed. There's actually a strong analogy to saying you walk into a laboratory and there's some condensed matter system there, and you walk in and you look at it and it's tuned right to a second order phase transition. Whether it's temperature or electric fields or something, has some parameter that you can tune the system that drives it to a phase transition. Because at a second order phase transition, you get correlation lengths that are very large compared to the atomic spacing. Normally, if you walked into a room and you saw, you know, some system there, you would say it's right at the second order phase transition. It's a miraculous discovery that something has been tuned just right so that I got these enormous correlation lengths. So if you don't believe that that's what's going on, if you don't want fine tuning, the next question is, first you say, okay, there's new physics, maybe at around a TeV, maybe a few TeV. The question is, what could that new physics be? Because if I really want the next theory to go all the way up to the Planck scale, there's got to be a symmetry that forbids scalar masses. What symmetry could forbid a scalar mass? There are two known symmetries that could forbid a scalar mass. One is phi goes to phi plus a constant. That obviously is violated by phi squared times m squared. Anybody know what sort of symmetry this is? What does this signify? Sorry? Yeah, it's a Goldstone boson. It's an angle on some flat circle, and it doesn't matter if you change the angle. So this is just a Goldstone boson. This sort of symmetry tells you that all interactions of the phi field have to be proportional to derivatives of the phi field, so you can't have a mass term. Unfortunately, you can't have a gauge coupling either. Well, now you have to play a game. Well, maybe I could break the exact symmetry a little bit, so it's a pseudo-Goldstone boson like the pion. The pion looks like a Goldstone boson, but the pi plus certainly has gauge interactions. It's light, but it's not massless, and so on. So maybe the Higgs is composite, or maybe the Higgs is a Goldstone boson is a better way of saying it. So pseudo-Goldstone boson. There's one other symmetry, it's sort of a parasitic symmetry. We've seen that fermions are protected from mass renormalization, additive mass renormalization. So we can have a symmetry that relates the boson to the fermion, and then it'll inherit all the good things that the fermion has. That symmetry is supersymmetry. So you have your fermion that has its mass is protected by chiral symmetry. When you have a symmetry that relates the scalar to the fermion, basically you've given a scalar field a type of chiral symmetry. So that's the second thing that's good about it. Now the history of supersymmetry is sort of interesting. In the 70s, when it was discovered, it was extremely popular because the thing that people really were intrigued by was the fact that the supersymmetric algebra had this equation here, that the anti-commutator two generators would give you the Hamiltonian. And therefore, supersymmetry is unbroken. Q has zero expectation value, tells you your vacuum energy is zero. And that would seem to solve the cosmological constant problem. A couple of problems with this idea. One was that we don't have exact supersymmetry in the real world, because there's no selectron that's the same mass as the electron. And even if it's only broken by a few hundred GeV, that would give us a vacuum energy typically of 100 GeV to the fourth, which is orders of magnitude off what we see. So that's one problem. The second problem is that when you actually, we only care about vacuum energy when we include supergravity, because vacuum energy is meaningless if you don't have gravity. You can all change your energy by a constant. But when you include gravity, supergravity actually in curved spacetime allows you to have non-zero vacuum energy. De Sitter space is a solution. You can have supersymmetry in De Sitter space. So the original motivation for supersymmetry, namely solving the cosmological constant problem, was not valid. And then around 1980 or so, Witten wrote a paper saying that really the cool thing about supersymmetry is that the quadratic divergences in the scalar masses cancel. And therefore, we could use it for solving the fine-tuning problem somehow. Now, up to now, people had tried to write down supersymmetric theories and found that it's very difficult to get the phenomenology right. You typically would get light superparticles that you don't see. So what George and Demopoulos did is they said, okay, let's take the Witten idea seriously, say the real reason for supersymmetry is the cancellation of quadratic divergences. And they said, well, if we break supersymmetry softly, namely if we give different mass terms to the electrons, to the particles and the sparticles, okay, that breaks supersymmetry explicitly in the Lagrangian, and yet it doesn't change the property of the high energy property of the graphs, and you still have quadratic divergence cancellation. Now, everybody at the time went, ah, that's gross, yuck. You know, why take supersymmetry so beautiful and throw in all these messy, explicit supersymmetry breaking terms? It was extremely unpopular. It's now called the MSSM. So this is just a moral that tastes change. In the original days, nobody wanted to break supersymmetry. It's too pretty. Okay, so we've got this dogma now. Most of my career, the whole preoccupation of particle physics has really been solve the fine-tuning problem. So people have come up with all these different solutions to solving the fine-tuning problem in the Higgs, but there's this other fine-tuning problem, which is the most irrelevant operator of all, namely one, the vacuum energy. No one's come up with a good solution to that until... So that Weinberg actually did a RevMod Phys survey of every attempted solution of the cosmological constant problem and showed that none of them worked. Okay, so he said, well, if no mechanism works to solve the cosmological constant problem, maybe we're looking at the wrong thing. So he says, let's suppose that the universe could have different vacuum energies in different places. So the cosmological constant is not a constant, it's a locally defined thing, maybe, but local over a space much bigger than our horizon. This is an idea that only became possible after the idea of inflation came through. Now he says, now we have this ensemble of different patches of the universe, all with different vacuum energy. And some of them, most of them, let's say, will have a huge cosmological constant. So let's just assume that there's some a priori probability distribution which is monotonically increasing, that large cosmological constant is more likely. Well, he said then that in most parts of these universes, okay, so a cosmological constant looks like a force between objects. So the force between you and me would be like an inverse spring. There's an R squared repulsion potential between us. That's what a cosmological constant does. And if it's big enough, you'll never be able to form galaxies because the gravitational attraction is countered by this R squared repulsive potential. So he said, if that happened, no life would be possible. If you can't form galaxies, life's impossible. So what we really should ask is not what is the probability that a large part of the universe is a small cosmological constant. That's a tiny probability. But what's the probability that we're in a patch of the universe that has small cosmological constant? Okay, and that is very high because we could not be in any other part of the universe. So that's called the anthropic principle. And he suggested that there was an anthropic reason for why the cosmological constant was small, and predicted, therefore, that if the probability is rising, then it's most probable that we are in a part of the universe, a part of the larger universe where the cosmological constant is just small enough to allow galaxy formation. That gave him a very low cosmological constant, but not low enough. It gave him, I think, some MeV to the fourth or something. This has been refined a bit and brought it down, but he was incredibly unpopular. Okay, everybody knew the cosmological constant was zero because of some symmetry that we just hadn't discovered yet. Okay, but he predicted it would be non-zero, and then 10 years later, it was discovered to be non-zero. So Weinberg is my hero. Okay, because and it's really a good lesson again that he didn't care what other people said or what they thought. He didn't care about the dogma. He said, if all of the possible mechanisms don't work, then the impossible mechanism must be the solution. There are other ways that fine-tuning might be handled. It's possible that, okay, when you look at an organism that you discover under some leaf outside, you don't say, ooh, this is bizarre and incredibly unlikely, you know? Well, it's the product of billion years of evolution. There were a gazillion unlikely things, and all of them got squished except for this one, okay? And that's why we have this weird one here. So maybe there's some dynamical process by which the universe ended up looking like it does now. Okay, so an example, in 1997, I gave these TASI lectures, and I had just been at a conference where I was overwhelmed by how smug the supersymmetry theorists were at the time, and they all were working on exactly the same thing, and they were sure it was absolutely right. It's been ruled out what they were working on since then. But so I wrote this little parable I stuck in my notes, and the idea there was, we've seen fine-tuning before due to dynamical effects, and the example I give there is famous in kinetic matter or statistical mechanics circles. It's called something criticality. I forget what it's called. Anyway, the point is that if you go along a beach and you look at the sand dunes are often all at the same angle, okay? And what's going on is that wind is loading the sand onto the sand dune, and then when it reaches a critical slope, it avalanches, and that makes it a little less steep. And then wind dumps some more, and it makes it steeper, and then it avalanches and goes back. And if you look at the critical slope on a windy day, you'll typically find that all the sand dunes are right at the critical angle for having avalanches. Just a small little bit of extra sand will cause it to slide. This is an example of a system that's tuned to a critical point through dynamical processes. Okay, and so you might wonder if there's any way of doing that with the Higgs mass. And there's actually was a very interesting paper that came out recently called the Relaxion by somebody named David Kaplan, who is not me, but who was my wife's graduate student. And I'll talk about that later in the lectures. Okay, so there was another topic I was going to discuss today. I'm not going to start it right now, but I'm just going to give you a taste for what it'll be. I guess I will start it a little bit. So up to now, we've talked about irrelevant operators, such as proton decay, neutrino masses. And we've talked about relevant operators in the fine-tuning issue, like the Higgs mass. What about marginal operators? So marginal operators are really cool because they're scale invariant, okay? But typically, quantum mechanical theories are not scale invariant because they involve divergences, and the divergences require renormalization, and when you renormalize, you introduce a scale into the problem. Now, there are truly scale invariant theories, conformal field theories, but clearly our world is not one of them, okay? So what happens is that in the real world, unless there's some weird conformal symmetry at high energy, what happens is with marginal operators is that quantum mechanics is going to tip it one way or the other. It's going to become slightly marginal, or slightly relevant, or slightly irrelevant. Now, slightly, what I mean is that there's going to be some quantum correction, so there's going to be some alpha over 4 pi, which tips it one way or the other. And if it tips it towards the relevant, that means it becomes more important at low energy. And an example of that is QCD, where the coupling constant becomes strong at low energy. But the neat thing about it is that typically the running is logarithmic, and so you get an exponential hierarchy of scales. So, for example, lambda QCD is roughly M Planck times e to the minus a number times 4 pi over alpha strong at M Planck. So if I tell you what the strong coupling is at M Planck, I can compute this, and I find that I get a lambda QCD, which is related to M Planck by this factor here, and this factor here is extremely small because the running is so slow. So alpha at M Planck is maybe a 50th, and it takes a very long running all the way down to an extremely low, 19 orders of magnitude before alpha gets strong. If you become slightly irrelevant, then you're like QCD, where, so QCD looks like that. And QED goes the opposite direction. And you get what's called the Landau pole. And as I mentioned earlier, these theories are sick unless some new physics, if we're actually looking at an effective field theory where new physics cuts in before then. So, for example, we have a U1 in the real world, of course, but if it gets grand unified into SU5, it becomes asymptotically free at the gut scale. And so this Landau pole isn't real. But it's these theories that blow up that are really interesting, because you get a new scale in the problem. Your fundamental scale is M Planck, but you get a new scale in the theory appearing, which is exponentially far away. Now, what I was going to tell you about is not QCD, which you've had in quantum field theory course, but about another example, which is superconductivity, where the same thing happens, where what you get is Cooper pairs between electrons. And the size of the Cooper pair is typically 1,000 times the lattice spacing. And that's pretty weird. Got these electrons which are traveling through this lattice, and there's all sorts of stuff happening at the lattice spacing scale, and somehow these bound states form that are huge compared to the size of lattice spacing. So that is why the temperatures for superconductivity are very low compared to the temperatures needed to rip apart the crystal or something. So how does that happen? So I'm going to just start by writing down the theory for this. The important thing to know is that what you've got in a metal is you've got a Fermi surface. Of course, it's not usually a sphere, but it's going to be a sphere in my discussion. So Fermi surfaces, what I've done is I've filled in all these electrons, and they're degenerate. I've filled up all my states up to a certain level, and they're filled up to the surface level. And this is called the Fermi, the radius is called the Fermi momentum. So that's sort of what goes on inside a crystal. And I want to discuss the theory here. So my action is going to look like, for the free theory, where I haven't introduced interactions between these, I'm going to write it in this mixed form of momentum and time instead of space and time. I'm talking about electrons. I'm also summing over spins. And I've got a kinetic term for these electrons. And then I've got the dispersion relation, which is maybe complicated. And I'm going to subtract out the Fermi energy, because I'm only interested in the energy relative to the Fermi surface. So this is substituting the usual p squared over 2m, because it's not p squared over 2m here. It's much more complicated. These electrons are moving through a crystal. And so this is some function of p, the dispersion relation for the electron in the crystal. And I'm subtracting off the Fermi energy just to say that's where I'm going to be measuring energy from the surface here. Now, if there, I can't ever get an electron, I'm never talking about electrons down here. All the interactions are going to be near the surface. If electrons scatter, what happens is they're going to be knocking each other up above the surface, and you'll get holes below the surface. But typically, the energies of scattering are not going to empty out a state way down here. So the energy scale I'm interested in is near the Fermi surface. So what I'm going to do then is I'm going to say for a given momentum particle, I'm going to divide it up into two pieces. I'm going to say that my momentum is K plus L, where K goes to the Fermi surface and L is the distance above the Fermi surface. And now when I count dimensions, when I count scaling, when I'm talking about low energy, I'm not going to be talking about actually low energy anymore. I'm going to be talking about near the Fermi surface. So I'm going to be talking about scaling little L. So little L is going to be my scaling variable where I talk about low or high scales in the theory. However, K is fixed. Maybe its direction is not fixed, but its magnitude is fixed because it's sitting on the surface of the sphere. So when I do power counting, it's this scaling property that I'm going to talk about tomorrow. And what I'm going to do then is introduce the most general for fermion interaction. And I'm going to ask, is this relevant, irrelevant, or marginal? And what we'll find is sort of interesting, which is that in general, it's irrelevant. If it's irrelevant, then that means that no matter what interaction you have at high energy, namely at the order of the lattice spacing, in the low L limit, you'll find that these are free particles. And that's what's called a Landau liquid. It says that a metal looks like the electrons are all free particles. However, what you find is for very peculiar kinematics, when the electrons are coming head-on towards each other, you find that this interaction is marginal. And if it's marginal, it turns into the same problem we saw in two dimensions with delta function scattering. If it's attractive, it becomes asymptotically free, and you get a superconductor. If it's repulsive, it's asymptotically unfree, and you get a Landau liquid. And which it is depends on the material. And that explains why some metals behave like Landau liquids and some of them behave like superconductors. So, well, the main thing I'm going to talk about is how do you see that this is marginal in that funny kinematics.